Hey, this is Lita Ford, and you are listening to Combat Radio. Crank it!
Kiss me once! Kiss me twice!
Listening to Brigade Radio 1.
I don't know what's wrong with me. I'm acting like a fool. You got me doing things, Lord, I swear I never do. I don't understand the way you're treating me. I swear I'm gonna break out. Can you hear me coming this plea? Got me sitting here with no chance of bail.
Hey everyone, it's Ethan with Combat Radio and Brigade Radio 1. We're actually at Agora, backstage at the Canyon Club for what is going to be an epic night of music. That's right, tonight's very, very special guest is one of our favorites, a living legend, a guitarist, if you will. You know him as Coco Montoya. Coco, how are you?
I'm doing fine, boss. Thank you for letting me come out here and bend your ear.
No, this is a privilege. So let me ask out of the gate. You got a pretty cool name. Now, do we call you Coco or do we call you Mr. Montoya? And is that a name you gave yourself or were your parents just
actually,
that hip?
Actually, a girl gave me that name when I was playing drums with Albert Collins back in the 70s, and it kind of stuck.
Yeah.
Some girl that I dated for about maybe a month at the most, and she left me with that. So my real name is Henry, which a lot of people don't know that, but yeah, I've been called that since then.
Well, I looked at that poster and I said, that has got to be the coolest name in rock and roll. And I wondered, because so many people are theatrical with their moniker, I said, I wonder if his parents were that cool, or if he was just cool enough to think to make the transfer. And now we got the story. So you're here at the Canyon Club for what is going to be an epic night of music, and I want to let people know that there are still tickets available. We're expecting a sellout, but there are still tickets available, and this is something you're not going to want to miss. What is the latest with you?
Well, I got a great band, and I got a brand new album out, just came out. Coming In Hot is the name of the album, and well, I call it album because I'm an old man,
right?
But CD, at least that.
Still call it albums too, and I'm constantly correct.
But yeah, on Alligator Records, Coming In Hot, and I got a great band. We're gonna have a great time tonight. I got Jeff Paris on keyboards, which is just a phenomenal musician. He's recently joined the band. And Renee Beavers on drums and Mr. Nate Brown on bass. And we're really, really having a great time playing together.
Well, we're going to play some tracks so people can get a sense of what you're talking about. Let me ask you, what is your favorite album? What do you listen to?
Gosh, I listen to such a variety of things. You're talking about my stuff? Or
yeah,
talking,
well, no, it's in general. I mean, do you actually sit down there and play a bunch of Coco Montoya records?
No, not at all. No, very, very, very rarely. I mean, if I have to rehearse something up for put it in the, you know, rotation,
right,
I'll listen to it. But I don't really listen to the albums very much.
Who's your favorite?
Oh, God, there's so many. Clapton is still one of my idols. You know, B.B. King, of course, you know.
What is it about Clapton, would you say? Like, do you sit back and... Have you ever met Clapton?
No, never have.
No?
Never have.
Because, you know, you guys were both with John Mayall at
right.
one time. So I wondered if you guys ever got in some sort of UK jam session or something.
No, never had the chance. I would love to do that. It would be great. But I don't see that coming down the pike.
The rumor is that you are Clapton's favorite guitar player. I'm just throwing that out there.
Wow. Well, that would be interesting to hear. I haven't heard that ever before. But yeah, a lot of what I do just comes from his inspiration and his playing. And
yeah.
I mean, since I was a kid, I've listened to him. Very, very much taken with what he's done.
Now, you're a local LA resident, as am I, and I should apologize to the audience. They're sound checking right behind us. We usually do these things in a live audience, so you're used to it. But if you pick up the occasional vocal or drum beat, that's what's going on. This is a working environment. You're an LA resident. How does a kid like you, because we're about the same age, but you found the blues, looks like you found the blues and fell in love with the blues before I did. So what's the... How did that happen?
You know, in L.A., the experience of blues, which even if I didn't know what it was called, was pretty easy to come by because we had the Johnny Otis show on Channel 5 way back in the day. And Johnny would have everybody, Eddie Cleanhead, Vincent, Margie Evans, and the people like that. And we'd have plenty of people on TV. I mean, gosh, I've seen amazing amount of... musicians that you know playing on that channel, and many others as well. We had a lot of good, a lot of people from Houston, you know, Dallas, South Texas players. A lot of them moved out here, and so you ended up getting quite affected by the blues, and you didn't even know it. And you know, with the advent of John Mayall and you know Eric Clapton, Peter Green, all these bands, you know, Fleetwood Mac and stuff, they would bring all that back to America, and we rediscovered it, you know.
We interviewed John Mayall, and he was kind of a man of few words about yes. a lot of things. You know, I don't think he was comfortable with being John Mayall, you know, in the public yeah. perception. But for you, you seem to be like a pretty easy guy to talk to, and a pretty relaxed individual. And playing the blues for you, like when you sit back and you see these documentaries, like the one that just came out on like the guy that sold his soul to the devil at the crossroads.
Oh, Robert Johnson.
Yeah, have you seen all that? You listen, look at all these legends, and do you still listen to those records? Like, do you listen to like Muddy Waters records and go,
"There's the magic." There it is. There it is. Yeah, yeah. You listen to Muddy or people like that, and it really, if you're listening correctly, you get the real root of all this kind of music. And still to this day, you know, I listen to a lot of the old players, you know. Uh-huh. And having an influence like Albert Collins in my life, you know, it's just, that to me is one of the originators, you know, just a wonderful, wonderful.
Well, what would you say about Albert Collins?
On a personal level, one of the sweetest, greatest guys in the world. Musician-wise, could say so much with very few notes and affect you. And it's his persona on stage with that power he had. He wouldn't be denied. You could not ignore when Albert was on the stage. You had to pay attention to what he was doing.
Is it sometimes what you don't play?
Absolutely.
You know,
that's a goal. I think a lot of good players, especially. We try and constantly tell ourselves, you know, I'm not one of them, but when I have to go and say, need to shut up, say, you know, say more with less words, and you know, when I'm playing guitar, because sometimes I tend to overplay, you know.
But is that emotion that takes charge of it? Like, are you in the moment?
Yeah, I think that I work completely off emotion. Sometimes it doesn't work to my benefit, and sometimes it really does. But I mean, everything I do has to come from an emotional place.
Do you have a moment where you sit back and you go, man, that's the moment where I knew I was going to make a living? Like, I could tell my parents, don't worry, I don't need the job at Safeway, I don't need the paper route, I'm going to make it as a guitar player. Where was that moment where that you suddenly had that?
You know, I don't think I ever had that, ever. I mean, until I like got into the band with John Mayall, I mean, that was really where I was actually making a living.
Was that like a weekly check? Was that your first weekly check?
As a musician, that you know, we got paid by the tour, you know, how many shows were in the tour, X amount of dollars and whatever. But that was the first time I'd made money in that kind of way. You know, usually I was playing like little small places for $40 here and there, and had a day job, you know.
What year was this, can I ask?
Oh, with John?
No, what year were you playing for $40 a day?
Oh, God, that was in the 70s, early
70s. 70s.
Yeah,
right.
I first played in a bar in Culver City, California when I was 19. I was not supposed to be in there.
Right. What bar was it?
That was a Safari Room.
Oh, yeah. Is it still there?
No, it's gone. It's all gone. Yeah.
So you get the job with John, and then you got a tour, and you realize, oh man, I'm going to be able to come back and eat for a while, and this is what it's really about, right?
It was like a thrill, you know, because I was such a John Mayall fan and such a fan of the players that he had in his band. I listened to that stuff, you know, the Beano album with Clapton. I must have worn out many, many copies of that, you know, just loved everything. I still, to this day, I kind of center myself with that album.
How did it come about? Like, what was the call? That did you just wake up to a phone call from John Mayall one day, and he's like, "Coco,
actually,
I need you."
I was at work, and I was bartending at a club a pub in Laurel Canyon, and it was owned by Kim Gardner from Ashton Gardner and Dyke, bass player. English guy, he knew everybody, you know, and of course he owned the place, so everybody would come down, and
right.
There'd be you know, Charlie Watts from the Stones and Jeff Beck and Tom Jones and all these guys would come down there. And I thought it was one of the guys that I'd met, all the roadies there, they're all English guys, and they were giving, you know, putting me on, you know.
Yeah.
So I pretty much hung up on him the first time he called. He heard a tape of me and said that, you know, he was reforming the Blues Breakers and wanted me to come down. It took another call from him to oh, you really are John Mayall.
So did you hang up and immediately get that call back, or did he give it a couple of days, or did someone else call you?
He called me back.
Right away.
I said, yeah, you're John Mayall. Yeah, sure. And I hung up, you know, and that was very weird. Yeah, but he said, no, I need to know from you now if you'd like to come down and kind of audition, you know, have some other players coming to do that. And we did it at the Central Club, in the, which is the Viper Room now.
Yeah.
Went in there during the day, and we sorted out the band that day. And John said, do you want to do it or not? You know, and I told him, I need a couple of days to figure out if I wanted to get back in the music business. I wasn't in the music business anymore.
Right.
And to come back as a guitar player, as I was a drummer before that. So it was a whole life change, complete life change, with John Mayall asking me. He brought me back into the music business.
Saved you?
Yeah, pretty much.
So he's like the blues Jesus.
He's amazing. He's amazing. He was an amazing man. Taught me a lot.
I have a feeling that you're not the first person to hang up on him. I see that happening quite a bit. I think he's made the calls repeatedly.
Well, the only reason why I did is because I didn't believe it was him. So.
Right. Well, you're not a rude guy. I will say for the audience, when I walked in here, this guy was very welcoming. You know, and that's not usually what you get when you step backstage to see somebody. So I could see that you and John probably hit it off. So you go down to where the Viper Room is now. You obviously passed the audition.
Yeah, I was one of them that got the show. You know, it was the first guitar player. The other guitar player was a great player named Cal David. And so we did a year together, Cal and me, and Willie McNeil on drums, and Bobby Haynes on bass.
Was it easy working with John Mayall? Was he a pretty easy boss, or was it very strict?
It was very organized and structured, you know, which is something I hadn't been used to, but I really thought a lot of how great this was, that you had to be on your time, you had to be in the lobby when it's time to be there, you had to be ready to do your job, mm-hmm. You know, which I appreciated a lot. The pressure of being with John was just to try and do these hits and these legendary songs that he recorded, that he did with Eric Clapton and he did with Mick Taylor and Peter Green and the people like that, you know. That's where the pressure comes in later. You didn't think about it until you're actually on, and mm-hmm. you realize that you've got to step up and make it your own.
Was that easy?
No, that was very difficult.
Like, so people are naturally, they're listening to a track that Clapton played for on the album and they're making comparisons. But at the end of the day, right, for people who are in similar positions, your advice would be, you just do the best you can. Or what would you tell these people that are doing something similar?
The best you is always the best.
Right.
You know, I'm trying to be, I could never be Eric Clapton. I mean, I definitely have borrowed a lot of, you know, his playing, is in my playing. But I can never be him. No, I mean, that's the whole deal. It's like Albert Collins used to always say, he says, just hold your own, son, just be you. Mm-hmm. He says, I love B.B. King. He's like a brother to me. He says, but I don't want to play like B. I want to play just like I play. And that's really the search began then, was just that if you're going to be in this, you need to search for your own identity. And that's really where you need to be.
Oh, man, that's one of life's great lessons, isn't it, right there?
Yeah, absolutely.
That is musical advice that we would be able to sell to the public.
It's absolutely true. I mean, it's a very simple, basic concept. It's just... you know, if you're going to get up on stage and you're going to play Stormy Monday, say,
right.
Well, if you're going to do it just like T-Bone Walker, what are you really accomplishing? Why don't you do it your interpretation of it, what you feel, how you feel it? You know, but if you're going to play it lick for lick like the record, to me, you're being a parrot.
If you could resurrect a bunch of blues icons that have passed away and form a band, who do you pick?
Oh, God, there's so many. Magic Sam, definitely one. Albert Collins, for sure. You know, people like that, absolutely. Buddy Miles, you know. Sonny Freeman, great drummer, played with B.B. King. I would love to hear him again, you know. So many great players, like Donald Duck Dunn, you know, all these great people.
And do you have a moment from your road or your career where you go, this is this is actually happening. This is why I'm in the music business. This is a wonderful moment. This is just a cataclysm of awesomeness right here. Do you have a couple of moments that stand out like that?
Oh yeah, I can think of many little gems that I have. One time I was playing with John in New York at the Beacon Theater, and we were playing, and there was a man in a wheelchair sitting off to the side watching the whole show. It was Doc Pomus. And just to realize it was Doc, when I got off the stage, he goes, "Man, you sounded great. Really soulful stuff." I was in shock. I mean, Doc Pomus is one of the greatest songwriters, you know, in the world. He wrote so many hits, you know, it's unbelievable. So those moments are like that. Hanging out with B.B. King, those moments where it was on a personal level. And you know.
Well, translate some of that. Like how, when you're hanging out with B.B. King, like what sticks with you? Like what are some of the things he said to you that you'll always remember?
I think the first thing, first meeting I had with B.B. King, we were playing the Ann Arbor Blues and Jazz Festival, Ann Arbor, Michigan, but I think it was up in Canada. I think they moved it up to Canada over the border. And we drove all couple days all the way deadhead from West Coast to East, you know. And they gave Albert Collins a really bad call on that one. They tried to cut his money. And I was a little insecure about my playing. But I was really really devoted to Albert Collins, and we tried to straighten the money situation out. And B was really helpful in getting that to happen. And at the time, Albert said, "B, he's like a son to me." He said, "Albert said he sometimes needs a little confidence, though, you know." And B just said, "Son," he says, "you just go up there like you're the baddest there is in the world." He says, "Ain't nobody better." He said, "But when you're done with it, and you're coming off the stage," he goes, "be humble. Leave that ego up on stage." He goes, "It'll always be there when you come back." He says, "But be humble when you come off the stage," because then whatever it is you did, you just multiplied 1,000 by just being humble when you walk off the stage. Be thankful. Those people don't have to love you. So if they do, be grateful.
That is beautiful, man.
That's true.
So tonight's show at the Canyon and Agora on Roadside, not to be missed. You miss this, you better be dead or in jail. And if you're in jail, break out. Perhaps one of the greatest you'll ever get a chance to see tonight. And what, you have any dates passed tonight that the audience needs to know about?
If you can't... I'm not around here. No, we're heading up to Sacramento tomorrow.
Yeah. But you are a local resident, so maybe I can have you come into our home office on the Universal Backlot and do a part two.
I would love to.
Yeah.
You better subscribe to this channel before you look uncool.